I consider this a great honor to be here. I feel like you folks getting up this early in the morning and this many of you here, it's really a precious opportunity. I don't know if you can hear me through this. Am I okay? I don't think this is on. A little bit more? Okay, I'll hold it closer. So I consider this a real honor and a charge because you're devoting your time, and I want to treat that very respectfully. I am very glad to be here. I made a commitment early this year that every webinar I do, every seminar I do, every speaking engagement is going to be completely new. So there's a certain amount of terror with every one of them because I've never talked about what I'm going to talk about today. And I hope you find it interesting. One of the things that I found interesting, I don't know if you know this, but if you're ever asked to speak at Creative Mornings, you can only do it once. And that's not just once in Atlanta, but once anywhere. But then I thought, I wonder if maybe I'm the only one they told that to. But it also, it's a relief because like when I don't get called back, I'm not lying there wondering, oh, that must have been terrible. No, nobody gets invited back, so that's a relief. I'm just gonna talk for a few minutes really, and I have just a few points. They're not a lot of them. We don't have a lot of time, and I'd rather leave some time for questions as well. So the theme is crossover, and I hate alliteration. This is just an accident, but it's about. I want to put crossover in the middle of two thoughts. One is competence, and the other is creation. Okay, and all of these photographs are mine, and that's what makes the talk a little more meaningful to me because I really developed it around some themes that I'd been seeing and shooting over time. So just in summary, we're talking about competence first. And so if you are interested in making an impact on your world, which is a silly notion really, because everybody is interested, even if they don't admit it, we want to have an impact on our world. We want people to appreciate knowing us, to have learned something from us. And I think about this often when I think about you folks toiling away, doing creative things every day. How are you changing the world? And I think we have this mistaken notion that you, for instance, are changing the world through your work. And 20 years from now, if you fast forward, or maybe some of you who are older, maybe we should say 10 years, or some of you younger, 30 years, you fast forward and you look back on your life and you think to yourself, who will remember the work that I did? Not that many people. It's a sobering thought, right? The client that you're mildly annoyed at this moment, they're not going to remember the work you did. They may remember your personality if it was memorable in a bad way. They won't. Who will remember what you were doing 20 or 30 years ago at that point, looking back on your life? It'll be the people that you worked with. It'll be your boss. It'll be the people that you were the boss to. It will be the people that you rub shoulders with. If you're trying to impact your world, that's usually a safer place to think about the impact that you're going to have. But if you're going to impact your world in your job, how do you do that? And the main point I'm trying to make first is that you're going to impact the world around you by just being competent, doing your job. Just tame the genetic ADD that seems to be a part of this industry and relax a minute and realize that it's not death to simply do your job for 3 or 4 years and earn competence. Get in there and work at it hard. After you've done that, the next phase allows you can do the crossover thing, leaving strength, leaving some things behind, specifically leaving some things behind, and that's the big second point. Is when you do, what allows you to leave your job, to to cross over, I don't mean leave it specifically, but to learn some other things, is leaving from a position of strength, from competence. And during this second phase, you don't add additional goals to your life. You decide which ones you're going to drop, and there are some specific techniques about which ones you add I want to talk about in just a second. And then you create seeing new patterns against the old one. So that's just an overview of this. Let me go through this, and this is something that I took a picture of in an elevator, and it just struck me. I missed my floor, actually, as I was taking a picture of this with an iPhone. It said, life isn't about finding yourself. Life is about creating yourself. And there are times when this would apply to some of you and not so much to others, but you wonder, okay, what is my role in this world? How often do you ask yourself that question? Every day, some of you? Some of you maybe every 2 years, you're at a job, you've worked for Matchstick for 2 years, and you're thinking, oh my God, I gotta find a different job. No, I'm just kidding, that's not. But how often do you ask this question? And it's not about finding yourself, it's about creating yourself. It's using an opportunity. In this vein, if you think at all, and I'm assuming that you do, we think to varying degrees. These are some of the thoughts that I think might go through your mind. You struggle to see where you are in the process of creating yourself. If you think at all, you wonder how much you really know. And you say, okay, is this, what is it that my boss gets from me? What is it that I contribute? Blake mentioned the notion of hobby, job, company. And if you want to figure out where you are in those three things, a hobby is something that costs you money. If you're a new business owner in the creative field, it's probably just a hobby at this point. You're paying in order to do stuff for other people. A job is what you get in exchange for working, and that's what most of us are at this point. And then if you have a company, it's more than that. But how much do I really know? Where am I in this process? You wonder about the worthiness of the entire marketing industry. That's really not a brilliant thing for me to say, since my job is to really advise folks in the marketing industry, but it's just honest. I think sometimes I'll be driving through a city and I try not to do this too often, but I'll just say, okay, I'm just gonna look at all the messages I read, and so much of it is just bullshit. What you do most every day is bullshit. It is, isn't it? So how do you place yourself in an industry where that's true? I think most of the things that you're trying to help your clients sell are sort of in that middle category where they don't really hurt or help people. It's okay, it's a loan, it's a new razor, and then there's the evil stuff at the bottom and then the really good stuff at the top, and we all wanna be up at the higher end of things, but what is it about? Like, I would love for there to be more transparency and authenticity in marketing. I would love branding to not be bullshit. I'd love it to be real. I'd love it to go back to its roots. As you look across a field and the farmer can't tell which cow's pregnant, which one needs extra vitamins, let's brand them. Let's wrestle the cow to the ground. Let's burn its ass with a hot iron and it's screaming and we smell burning hair. That's branding and it's permanent. I would love for there to be more authenticity around branding. And what's your role in this? What do you do? If you think at all, you wonder about the worthiness of the entire industry that you're working in. If you think at all, you wonder if you are stupid, but only everyone else knows it. This is why I'm not a motivational speaker. I've tried to. I tried it a couple years and it just didn't work out. Or you wonder if maybe you're the only smart person in the world. So it's like you can have these same thoughts just seconds apart from each other. And And if you think at all, you'll falter at times. You'll wonder, okay, what is my place in the world? The theme on the first slide was, how do you impact your world as a brilliant creative soul? And if you think at all, you will falter at times. And you look across, just at this point, as I was thinking about what to say, I'd thought of some pictures that speak to me in terms of, like, I can't really see what's there. What's there? Is that a rock? When do these lines merge? There's a person in here. That's what I was trying to capture right here. What is this person's role? What do we know about them? Another person on the left walking into the frame. This car in Taipei that was so interesting. It was just cloaked. And I wanted to capture motion, and so I shot the image when a truck was passing, and you can see the movement as it goes across. And you think about all this stuff, and you see cars moving, and you see a bus, and you wonder, is this thing going to hit me? And then I thought of this beautiful girl, Josephine, who was adopted from Kenya. A friend of mine adopted her, and I did a photo shoot of her, and I think, this is how I feel sometimes. Eek, like what? Isn't she the cutest thing? I mean, this is how. And then the very next picture, this is a little photo shoot after breakfast, 5 minutes in a parking lot. The next picture speaks of the peace. Like, oh, it's okay. I know what my place in the world is. What is your place in the world? Back to that question. I think the first place you have in the world, and this is where you earn other places in the world, is just to do your job. Just do your job. Just whatever that is. Just do it. Earn respect. You be the kind of person that if you leave where you work, they want you back. They like fight to keep you. Because of who you are and because of your talent. And your talent is something that you have developed over the years. You've dug deep and you've looked for ways to improve it. And that's just who you are. You're a person who's committed, who's competent, who does their job. And when that happens, you know, GPSs are a little bit, you can't really see what's happening underneath, but remember the GPSs where when they were trying to acquire the satellites, they would get one satellite and you couldn't do anything with one, right? And then you got two and you're like, oh, okay, the sky's there, they're going to find some more. And then the third satellite comes up and then it tells you, okay, you can navigate now because you've got three, but as soon as we get four, then we're gonna be able to tell you where you are up and down. And it feels to me like every transition through this competence and then crossing over out of a strength, out of a reserve, and then creating, finding something new. Every one of those cycles that you go through helps you find one additional satellite so that your location in the world is just that much more precise. And each cycle, going through competence, crossover, and creation, adds a satellite so that you know, you get a clear indication of what your point is in the world. And I think, I've interviewed 14,000 people from the creative field over the years. And my sense in talking to them is that people usually go through four or five of these cycles. And they do something, they're very competent, then they cross over to something else, to sort of like a Venn diagram that has some relevance to what they were doing, but something different, they find new patterns. People go through that four, five, or six times, and each time you get a clear picture of your role in the world. Wouldn't it be interesting if we had all day today just to ask the person next to you, what is your role in the world? Not just what your job is, but what is your role in the world? What do you do? I can't answer that for you. I'm hoping just to help you think about it. One last time through this, okay? We start with competence. And what that means is that you need to be disciplined. When I look at firms, creative firms, and I try to draw the causation between successful creative firms and successful creative people and those who are not, it has almost nothing to do with raw talent. What it has to do with is discipline. Give me discipline And we can work on all the rest of it. But if you are not disciplined as a person or as a business owner, you're just not going to go very far. Be disciplined. That's part of competence. Learn from anyone. Anyone. Slide into meaningful conversations with authentic people. The kind of people that I love being around are ones who are funny, they're unpredictable. But the one common theme I've discovered about the people that I like to be around is that at any point, we could slide into a deeper, authentic conversation, even though we don't most of the time. I love small talk with people who can dive into an authentic, real conversation. Otherwise, small talk is very annoying to me. It feels like it's wasting my time. It feels like, why am I doing this? It's not leading anywhere. Gravitate toward world citizens. Those are the people you want in your life. If you really want to have an impact in the world, learn from people who are world citizens, who think globally, who don't think that the U.S. is the center of the world, who have traveled to some third world, some undeveloped country, anywhere, it doesn't matter, or Mississippi, one or the other. Sorry. They touch the subtleties and textures of the world. That's part of this authentic conversation that you can have. View the truth as your friend always. When you're younger, you sense that the truth is out there, but you don't really want it. And as you get older, you know the truth is out there and you welcome it. It's just a data point. It's not going to destroy your world. The sooner you find the truth, the better. In relationships, in business, in creativity, in your own skills, welcome the truth. It's always your friend. And fight fairly. Do you fight fairly with your boss? Are you the boss? Do you fight fairly with the people that you manage? With your coworkers? So that's the first thing. From that position of strength, then you cross over. You gather your strength and hold it. And in this process, I think it's helpful to picture homelessness and imagine whether or not you could live through that. Think of the worst and just decide if you can, because the worst isn't likely to happen. But if you know you can face it, then it just frees you up to move on out of strength into a scarier position during this crossover phase. Determine that it's an acceptable outside chance it might happen, but probably won't. And then make principled decisions based on who you are. I wish we could quit thinking so much about the implications of our decisions. The more we think about implications, generally, I'm worried about this because when I say it, those of you who are not self-aware, you're going to misunderstand this. But the more we think about decisions and the implications of them, the more we back away from the right decision. Quit thinking about implications. Just make decisions. Define success and failure for yourself. What does that mean? If you're a business owner, does that mean you have to have a 30-person firm? That's ridiculous. Success could be a one-person firm or it could be a 100-person firm. It makes no difference. How do you define success? There's too many people in the creative industry that are simply letting their clients define success for them. How many people do you have at your firm? The question is asked. Well, I've got 8. Well, so it must mean that's what the marketplace thinks you should have. That's backwards. You decide how big you want to be and then make the decisions to get to that point. Or you decide about your career. Make a decision in a world that makes too many decisions for you. That's part of having an impact on your world, is making decisions and not simply reacting to what the world wants from you. And then draw the clear air from a winter morning. That's what I love about this season. So that's the crossover phase. And finally, the creation phase. This, you're looking for an opportunity that's a slightly better fit for you because it could be within the same company, a slightly better fit for you because now you understand yourself better. And in this process, it's very useful to ask 24 friends. This is very, very specific here. Send an email out to 24 friends tomorrow and say, how would you describe my unique ability? use that phrase and see what kind of responses you get. You'll be surprised, first of all, at how similar the responses are. And all of a sudden you'll have a clearer picture of what your role in the world should be, whether it's, well, whatever it is, doesn't matter. It's helpful for other people to see that. Put down your unmet goals like a dear family dog, which we just did. That's why I use that. It's a terrible, terrible thing to do, but you have to. Quit adding goals to your life. There's just as much power in stopping something as there is in starting something. Decide which things are just like, oh, that was an interesting goal, but that's not going to happen. So just put it down. You can't just keep adding goals to your life and expect to meet them. Peel off the ones that are not likely to happen, that are painful to peel off, and then put more of your energy into the ones that really are more likely to happen. Notice the patterns around you, applying new ones on top of the old ones. And with writing, because I say here, because clarity comes in the articulation and not before. Some of you are writers professionally, right? But most of you aren't in this room. But I believe that all of you should be writing. Not, and this is a misconception about writing, you don't achieve clarity and then write. You achieve clarity in the articulation. And even if nobody reads your writing, in fact, if you aren't a good writer, that's a good thing. Even if nobody reads your writing, you should be writing, because the world needs to hear your articulated thoughts, and because unless you're writing, you're cheating the world in some way. I've just come to believe that everybody should write in some way, even if it's not professionally. Okay? So, do your job first. Second, cross over from a position of strength. And finally, simplify and create in your job and in your life. And then never stop. All right? Thank you.
Thanks, David.
You're welcome.
So, we're going to do a couple of questions, Q&A. So, if you have a question, raise your hand. David will call on you. And then, David, who is repeating the question? I'm actually backing this mic. We're not going to use that one.
Okay.
That we'll catch on the video. So, if you have a question, raise your hand, and David will call on you.
Yes. Yes. Why don't you stand up? How do you trust this process?
Yeah, I mean, you just define, you lay it out.
Yeah. Yeah. That's a question I think I have to answer personally, because I don't know how to answer that from your standpoint, but from my standpoint, there have to be some people in my life that whose guidance I trust. And actually, I don't think you want to require that trust happens along the way. I think you just have to keep doing it, and only in hindsight will you realize whether it was the right thing to do. I just think there needs to be constant movement in your life and not waiting too long to make a decision. Okay? Yes?
I would just ask, in your experience with crossing over with agencies, with people that you've met and interviewed, would you encourage mentorship or people to seek out a mentor in order for this process to take place?
Yes. So the question is, would you encourage mentorship in this process of creation and so on? I would, for sure. But I would try to only listen to people who have demonstrated success or discipline in an area where you're asking for their advice. Like, I'm just surprised that so many people listen to folks who are not successful financially about how to make money. You know, that's just a ridiculous concept to me. Or learning about discipline from someone who's not disciplined. So, yes, and I think that you don't necessarily want to choose the most obvious mentors, but the ones who are doing their job, you know, the ones who are demonstrating courage, ones who are, yes, but I think it's fantastic. In fact, when you look back on your life to bring that first question full circle, I think the influence you'll have will be on the individual people that are within your circle, right? And some of us have bigger circles than others, and it doesn't make any difference really. It's everybody has at least a dozen people who are going to be influenced by who they are. Yes, great question.
Let's do one more, David.
One more. Yes. You know, you thought you were going to win today. Did you see, like, she pointed to the other girl who did win, and like, you're going to be second. That was, all right, what's your question? Is about humility, or? I think there might be something I'm starting to realize for myself. I'm 54, so I should have realized this earlier, I'm sure, but I think, and the question again was, how do you balance your job with your interests outside of work? I think it's healthy to have those things separate, and if you happen to enjoy your job, I think that's fantastic and it's a gift, but I don't think it ought to be a demand or a requirement. I think you should do your job and you should earn whatever you're paid to do. And if you enjoy your job, that's fantastic, but it shouldn't be a requirement. And then from that position of strength, then you do some of these other things, but don't fly around and do 10 different things. Just pick two or three and do them from a position of strength rather than trying to mix the two all the time. And then you make weird business decisions when you must require, you require enjoyment from them. So that's what I would do. Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it.